After watching this video, you will be an expert in breeding Automeris and Hemileukinase species. Why? Because I'm going to tell you all their secrets. First, we're going to talk about what makes them unique and how to recognize them, because in order to breed them, you have to know them first and know what makes them special and how to recognize them and how to know their traits. First, let's talk about me, because who am I to spoon feed you all this information? Well, I do scientific research on this group of insects. I've shown you it before, but here's my first scientific publication. And it's about the life cycle and biology of Lonomia moth. If you want to read it, you should check some of my older videos. And it contains the link to my article. Either way, my video is not about my article. But it's just to show a little bit of credentials. I'm actually preparing a lot more scientific papers behind the scenes about this family. And I have bred many of them. If you are familiar with my YouTube channel, you know how many insects I breed. The majority of them are moths from this subfamily, right? Hemileukinae are a subfamily of Saturnidae. That means they are still silk moths. They share the same family with Atlas moths, with moon moths. They all have their own subfamilies, and Hemileukinae have their own traits, their own biology, and their own unique things. Let's tell you first. Why are they so interesting to me? Well, first of all, there are about 2,000 species of described Saturnidae and over 630 of them, yes, that's over one quarter of all Saturnidae, are moths from the Hemileukinase subfamily. That's quite a lot of them. And the reason that's interesting, because not a lot is known about them at all. I mean, there's the common species, but many of them are undescribed. There are still many new species out there who are totally new for science, but also the caterpillars of the majority of them are unknown. And I'm trying to record their life cycles and record their larvae and biology, because all of this is new information to science. All right, let's start about their dispersion first. Where can you find Hemileukinae? Well, only on the continent of America there are Hemileukinae. Nobody else, nowhere else in the world you can find them. There's a few species in North America, like Automeris io, Automeris zephyra, which can be common, or Hemileuca species like Hemileuca maya. But the majority of them are tropical species that live in South America. There are a few in Central America as well. Mexico has a few share of them. And all of them have wildly unique biology and very interesting evolution, in my opinion. So let's first talk about some traits. What traits do they have that other Saturnidae don't? First of all, you'll notice the toxic spines on the larva. Let's show you a few examples. If you touch these spines, it will probably hurt you. Why? Because they are actually venomous. They have venomous spines. And the sting ranges from, well, not just a little bit annoying, like Automeris io is annoying. It's like a stinging nettle. It's not going to ruin your day, but it's going to feel a little bit bad, you know. And you'd rather not get stung. And it ranges from that to very painful, like Durfia, for example. I felt some Durfia that were actually quite painful, to even deadly. Some moths from the genus Lonomia, for example, Lonomia oblica, yes, they can be deadly. Actually, they can take lives, because their venom is a hemotoxin, which means it's a toxin that affects the blood, and it works as a potent blood thinner that results in organ failure, in internal hemorrhages, actually brain hemorrhages and more. So that's not something pleasant to die from. It's very painful and dangerous, and people in Brazil die from Lonomia oblica. And it's one of the species I have bred. Actually, no, I haven't bred the oblica, but I have bred other species from the Lonomia genus. It's also what my research is about, right? Their medical significance is what makes them interesting. It's what makes them important to study. Apart from also being beautiful and fascinating, we have to know our enemy. Of course, they're not my enemy, but people consider them their enemy. And you know, it's you can derive medicine from them. You can make a potent blood thinner from their venom. All of it adds up. It's just a very interesting group. Well, let's just talk about some other traits that make them interesting. For example, their eggs have one unique trait. Saturniidae eggs have what's called a micropyle. The micropyle is the spot, an opening in the egg, where gas exchange happens. It means that from this place, the egg breathes. It takes oxygen from the air, yes. Eggs need oxygen to survive. But it's also the spot where the sperm cell enters the egg when fertilization happens. And in Hemileukinae, if fertilization happens, you can tell the eggs are fertile because the eggs have a black spot on them. Let's see some examples. Fertile eggs have a black spot, while non-fertile eggs have a green or no spot at all. It's very useful because when you buy eggs from them, you can instantly tell if they're going to hatch or not. And this isn't possible with the eggs of the majority of the species. Of course, there are some Saturniidae that have micropyles as well, but all Hemileukinae have it, which makes it quite easy and convenient for breeding them. And, well, that's one of their traits. Let's talk about some more. How to recognize them? The eye spots. Well, not all of them have eye spots. In fact, some of them don't have fancy colors at all. But species like Automerus, there are a lot of them, all have the typical eye spots on their hindwing. And another thing is leaf camouflage. Many of Hemileukinae are gray or brown and perfectly camouflaged like a leaf because of their forest environment or desert environment, where they pupate in leaf litter or spin cocoons on the base of tree trunks, where leaf camouflage is quite useful. When they emerge as moths, some will drop to the forest floor and play dead. And so there's basically eye spots and leaf camouflage that they often use as a strategy. They are also rather small moths. Of course, they are not extremely small, and even relatively speaking, if we take moths as a whole, they are actually big moth species. But for the family of Saturniidae, they are on the smaller side of the spectrum. Of course, there are exceptions. There are giant Automeras like Janus or Postalbida. They are very large. But the majority of them, like Automerus Io, they are small. And well, of course, it's not a definite thing to determine them on, but yeah, it's a trait. Also, an interesting trait is their rocking behavior. I don't know why this evolved. I think it's a neurological thing, because you can imagine a lot of Hemileukinae, they have the leaf camouflage I mentioned, and rocking like a leaf in the wind helps them convince birds they are actually just a leaf or something that's blowing in the wind. They are not actually a living creature. Even species that don't look like leaves, like Hemileuca, have this behavior. It's interesting, it's very ingrained in them. So I think that covers their general biology. By the way, if you want to study them, here's some useful books. For example, the book from Claude Lemaire is very interesting and useful. Also, what's also useful is there are a few websites on Saturniidae. I'll link them in the comments. Check out the comments for the links to study them. Let's talk about breeding them. What do they need in captivity? Well, there isn't one definitive answer, because there are so many species, over 600, and their habitat is all over South America, from the dry and very hot deserts from Chile to Argentina, where it can be very, very cold and dry, or hot and dry, to the Amazon basin, where it's very humid and warm all the time, And even in places like Brazil, it can be very cold if you have mountains or high elevations, where some moths have. Actually, even in the Amazon, it can be very cold in winter, especially at night. Some have to face frosts, and these frosts are actually compensated by heat waves. When the sun comes up, it's all crazy, and they feed on a lot of tropical plants. Lucky for them, most of them are very polyphagous. That means they feed on a very wide range of variety. And generally speaking, for example, outer mares, but many of them will take trees that occur in Europe and North America that make it easy for us to study them and breed them. Most of them, for example, if we take outer mares, most of them will take oak. Let's show you a video to illustrate it. Just for all of you to quickly demonstrate how wonderful oak is as a food plant for these kind of moths. Here we have Automerus caterpillar. They are being reared on oak, and inside this container are many species. For example, these caterpillars are of Automerus excreta and Automerus liberia. Two species with a quite different biology. But as you can see, they're living together and actually in a social setting. And they're doing quite well on oak, all of them. So yeah, that's the one. That's actually in here are three species. Automerus io is in there too. So that's three species right there on oak. But that's not all of it. There's much more to my point. Because here we have young hatchlings of the Periphoba rosacea, also a Hemileucinae species related to Automerus. As you can see, they're doing quite well, about to shed skin to the fourth instar, and they're being reared on, you name it, on oak tree. Oak really is power food for these kind of species, and most of them seem to enjoy it a lot. Last but not least, here we have actually a rare species of Automerus, yes. That's why I separated them from the other ones in a big container. It's the Automerus stasiae. Let's try and get a clear shot of the larva. There we go. Very interesting colors there on the larva. But that won't last long because as they grow bigger, they become green. Here we have an older caterpillar of Automerus stasiae. It's already green. By the way, guess what I'm rearing on? Guess what I'm rearing them on? On oak. Oak really is wonderful for Automerus. Really, really, I recommend it. Just a quick video. I have many more. I could show you 100 videos of this, even from my older breeding. I mean, what do we have here? More little hatchlings. They're a little bit too small to show on camera, but yeah, they're feeding on oak, and they're also an Automerus species. Quite a very rare one, actually. If you're curious about what species, you'll have to see in my upcoming videos. Either way, point is, I breed all of these on oak, and it goes very well for me. Of course, if you're going to breed a species, please study its biology first. Don't feed it oak blindly, alright? But I'm just trying to say the majority of them will like it a lot. The majority of Automerus will like it. If they're polyphagous and not specialists, I really like to use it as power food for them. Otherwise, Ligustrum and Bramble. Bramble actually kind of sucks for them, right? But it's one of the few things that remains green in winter. So if you want to breed them in winter, use Bramble, right? Otherwise, take the oak, take the Ligustrum. And well, let's talk about their eggs. Their eggs, of course, they should often be kept humid and on room temperature. Of course, most of these species come from South America, right? Where it's actually warm and humid, so they like it warm and humid. There are a few species that overwinter as eggs as well, like Hemileuca. You have to put them cold during winter, put them outside or in your fridge or whatever. And they'll make it through the winter. I think they like, they can even withstand frost. Of course, also not a tropical area. And if it's species from deserts like Ormiscodes, you should keep them very dry and also on room temperature. And what's interesting is Hemileucinae can take a long time to hatch from their eggs, longer than most Saturnidae. For example, Dervia centralis, I have eggs of them, but I also have eggs of Pseudartemeris lata. Dervia centralis can take 6 months to hatch from their eggs, and Pseudartemeris took me 7 weeks to hatch from their eggs. I think these are very resilient, as many of them spend the winter or the dry season in their eggs, so actually there's an advantage to them hatching late from their eggs. Another typical thing for them is their social behavior. They tend to flock together as caterpillars and have signaling chemicals that tell them to follow each other. That's quite interesting. I told you about the toxic spines before, and of course it all adds up, because it's a defense mechanism. They have strength in numbers. Often it's the case with the most toxic caterpillars who are dangerous to touch them, that if they stay together, they become a bigger threat than a single one. So birds and other predators know to avoid them even more. You know, it's strength in numbers. It's like a collective cactus. Don't touch it. It's venomous. It will hurt you. And that's just generally the case. They can be reared in plastic boxes really well, from my experience, because most of them tolerate high humidity. I don't like to sleeve them. Of course, there are species from dry climates that don't like the high humidity from plastic boxes. But yeah, generally it's very easy to put them in plastic boxes. And if it's too humid, just remove the lid, or replace the lid with netting or something that ventilates, and it will be fine. And what's important, another tip when breeding Hemileucinae, one of my breeding secrets, is order a lot of eggs, right? These species are often social species and will feed together in groups. That means the more larvae you have, the more success you have, because they stimulate each other to feed, right? And if you have a few eggs or only a few of them hatch, from my experience, and I have a lot of experience with them, small groups won't do well. They need big numbers, right? They stimulate each other to become alive, to feed and to be active. And if there's a few of them, they really tend to remain a little bit more passive and insecure. I don't know what it is. I think it's just the social behavior that needs to be stimulated by having large groups. And my biggest success with breeding these species has always come from breeding them in large groups. I always prefer to order 40 to 80 eggs at the same time. And if I have a low hatching rate, it probably means they won't make it. Yeah, it's true. You need large numbers. It's one of my secrets. And of course, there are a lot of genera. One of my favorites, for example, is Hypergeria, and they all seem to have these, you know, scare tactics, these beautiful, colorful eyes on their hindwings. It's just very nice to see. And I think that I just very briefly covered all the basics of this family, really. Let me think if there's a few other tricks I could share with you. I think that's pretty much it. I think it covers most of the things from this subfamily in particular. I have a massive passion for them. I don't know why. They're like stamps, you know. They're small, they're colorful, they're very detailed. Nothing is known about them. They're toxic. I love it. So fascinating, you know. If you watch my YouTube channel, I'll show you a lot of these species this year, because I ordered some very nice ones. I really hope they make it. And I'll do some venom sting tests as well. One of the most painful I ever felt were Dervia and Limero Dervia. Man, they're horrible. And I also like their cute colors. They're often fluffy and pink, and they're very good at survival. They have camouflage, they have toxin. They aren't as harmless as most Saturni. They aren't sitting ducks. They have multiple ways to defend themselves, and that makes them interesting in my opinion. Oh yeah, maybe one tips to get them to pair, right? Pairing Automeris and pairing species that are related to them can be a problem, because they don't like to pair with their own family. That's true. if they are inbred or if they are from the same bloodline, there's a chance you won't have any pairings at all, even with the easiest species, right? That's because they are social species, and social species often pupate close together in the same area. That means there will be a large chance for them to pair with each other when they hatch, because this entire group, this entire family is spun cocoons together, and so they smell, they have to smell each other's pheromones and recognize each other as family, because pairing with family is not a good idea, because it produces weaker offspring. That's the truth. And if your moths aren't pairing, it's probably the case that they are inbred or related. Another thing is observing their pairings is very hard. Why? Because most of them seem to pair for a very short time. Am I talking about 30 minutes, right? I have studied the genus Lonomia for 1.5 years. And despite breeding them in massive numbers in 3 generations, I have seen 0 pairings, because they pair for such a short while, it's impossible to notice. Even Automerus Io, which I've bred in very large numbers, I've only taken 1 picture of a pairing in my life, and I've produced many fertile eggs but never seen their pairings, because the moths, they attach to each other for 30 minutes and then they let go. So there's no trace of them pairing. So always save the eggs to make sure, because you can know for sure if they are fertile. Look at the dot on the eggs. If it becomes black, you will know that they are fertile, really. These are one of the basics to rearing these species. And I really have some nice species coming up, guys. Follow my YouTube channel, really. I'm not lying, of course. It's just still a secret for now. It includes some very rare Automerus that have never been bred before by anybody else. And well, I'm not going to spoil it yet. Well, whew, that was just a small rant. By the way, I look a little bit sweaty and dirty, but I just returned from my job and haven't even showered yet. I've been lifting heavy boxes all day and I haven't cleaned myself up, but yeah, I don't care. It's not a fashion YouTube channel, and I don't care about being sweaty and dirty, and maybe you like me that way, I don't know. Anyways, here's some of my breeding tips and tricks, really. Oh yeah, about hand pairing, don't bother. Really, hand pairing is a very good tactic to try and get Saturninae to pair. With most Hemileucinae is completely useless. Why? Because they have defense mechanism. If you touch them, either they freeze and play dead, for example these Dervia, or they will completely flip and drop to the floor and start flopping their wings and try to escape. And they won't. One of the tricks to hand pairing is having the moth cooperate, and these species won't cooperate at all. Of course, it's possible to hand pair them, but it's extremely difficult and most of the time fruitless. Try the natural pairing first. If the conditions are right, this will be very easy with these kind of moth. Also, overwintering. There's a few species that overwinter even in South America, and these species should be kept in room temperature and not be kept cold, because they'll die, because they're from tropical environments, really. And that was the ending of my video, guys. I'm gonna go take a shower now. That was it, just my small rant. And I hope you have a lot of success with them. Stay tuned. Whoop.